All right, everyone, I think we can go ahead and get started. First off, my name's Alex. I will be conducting the webinar just like I do each and every week. For those of you that are new, welcome. I hope you find today's session useful and helpful. For those of you that are returning, welcome back. Before we get started, I just want to give you a little rundown of how everything works. Up in your upper left corner, I believe, you should see two options, one for Q&A and one for chat. If at any point in time you have any questions, go ahead and submit them via the Q&A feature. It allows me to easily manage the questions, make sure that they're all getting answered and so forth. If you have any comments, go ahead and utilize the chat feature. If I'm going too fast, if you'd like me to cover something over again or go into a little bit more detail, go ahead and use the chat feature. But if you have any questions, please utilize the Q&A feature to submit them. Now, with that said, when you submit a question, if it doesn't pertain to what I'm covering at the moment, I'm going to set it aside and I will get to it towards the end of the session. After we cover the main topic for the day, then we do a general Q&A session where we can tackle any questions that come in. So questions that don't relate to what I'm covering during the main portion, get pushed aside and we tackle them at the end of the day. But they do all get answered. So just be patient with that. What else? The webinar is being recorded just like they are each and every week. The video will be available for viewing later on in the day. So if you happen to need to jump off for any reason, don't worry, you can always watch the video later on to see what you missed. The Q&A portion is not part of the video, so keep that in mind, but the rest of the session is recorded. You can always access those by going to our support portal, which is just iinsupport.getliveedit.com. And in our knowledge base section here, right in the middle, we have our webinar video gallery. And that's where we display and post all of our webinar videos. We always have the most recent one first, so this is last week's video. Today's video will be posted here later on today. So, all right, so that kind of is the rundown on how everything works. Again, if you have any questions, submit them via the Q&A feature. Any comments, you can utilize the chat feature. So that tackles that. What we're doing this week is we're continuing where we're going through and we're customizing a health coach template. And everything that we're doing can be done on any of the templates. It doesn't matter which one you're using. Everything that we've been covering so far, you can do on any template. We're not doing anything extravagant. Everything we're doing is pretty simple and pretty straightforward. I'm not adding any content other than maybe a few pictures here and there. Otherwise, we're sticking with everything that comes with the template. So all of the sample content, the provided recipes we'll be tackling, we'll be using the IIN supplied forms and the blog feed, everything that comes with your template. We're just going to change it up to make it a little bit more customized, I guess. So the site that we're using for our example is one of our newer templates, the Saver template. This is what the Saver template looked like. This is the home page. And today we're going to be tackling the My Training page, which looks like this. And so back to our homepage, this is where we started. We finished up our homepage last week. This is what our homepage looks like now. It's the same content, didn't do anything different there, just kind of changed some of the way that things look a little bit. So that's what we finished up last week, and this week we will be tackling the My Training page. So this is what we're starting with today. And by the end of the day, we'll have it looking completely different, without changing any of the content. So that's kind of what we're going with for this week. So so that's where we're going to start. We have a couple of things to finish up on the homepage. There's a couple changes that I want to make that we're going to tackle first, and then we're going to hop into the My Training page. So I'm not going to spend a ton of time explaining everything that we're doing. We did that in the first couple of parts. This is part four. So in part one and two, we spent a lot of time kind of going over the specifics of what we're doing. Now it's just kind of getting right to it. So I might be going a little bit fast for you. But again, if you want me to repeat something, just let me know. I'd be happy to do it. But for the most part, I'm not going to spend a ton of time explaining things, and we're just going to kind of get right to it. All right, let's get started. All right, so like I said, there's a couple things on the homepage that I want to kind of change a little bit. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to log into the site. Before we make any changes, we need to log in. And to log in, it's simple. Just go to your web address, and at the very end, type in /login. And sign in with your email and password. This is going to be the email and password you use to sign up for your site. If you can't remember your login information, click the forgot password, fill out your email information, click change password, and you're going to get sent a new email or a new password. So keep an eye out for that email. That's what you're going to use to log in. Once you sign in, you should see your little toolbar up across the top of the page like that. That lets you know you're signed in and ready to go. And I do recommend that once you sign in, you hop over to your profile and you change your password to something that you're going to remember. It makes it a little bit easier. Want to address one question. Question came in, hi, I'm just starting to build my website. Is there phone support available to begin with? Unfortunately, there is not phone support available. You do have access to our support portal at any time. We do have our webinars that we do every week, but you can go to the support portal, which again, you can access under your profile menu by clicking the help button, or just by going to iinsupport.getliveedit.com. We have our extensive library of videos and guides to help you get started. If you have questions or you run into problems, up on the top, you can create a support ticket if you want to. Just submit your question or your issue to our support team and they'll help you with that. We do have some appointment options that are available. These are not free. They do, I believe with your free trial, you have one a month perhaps. I'm not sure, can't remember. But you can do the design appointment or a design appointment if you want, a support appointment. That's another resource. And we also have our training website, which is kind of a really good all-in-one kind of getting started place. There's a section on getting started on a couple things that you could do to help you with the basics. Kind of a little introduction of how things work and so on. So those are a couple recommendations that I have that I would give you. But again, we don't have any phone support available. It's just not an option. So I will throw this into the chat window. There's the training website link for you. And we also have the link to the support portal that I will throw in there as well. I see in the chat window that Susan had a comment, the volume keeps cutting out. Is that happening to anybody else? Or is that just an issue that Susan is having? Okay. Laurel says she's got it just fine. Michelle says it's just fine. Susan, it might just be a connection issue on your end. But again, remember the videos, the session is being recorded. So if you do run into issues, you can always join in later on. You can always try to sign out and sign back in too. That sometimes takes care of it. So, all right. So let's back to it now. Okay. So a couple of things that I want to do for changing some settings on the homepage. Actually, one of the things that I want to change is I want to change a setting in our design tab, in our style settings. I want to change the way our buttons look. If you hover over one of the buttons on the site, we have this some of the color schemes that come up, and it's a little bit hard to read there. It's okay on the white part, but any colored background section such as this, it's a little bit difficult to read. So I'm actually going to go through and I'm going to adjust some of those settings a little bit. So I'm going to go into my design tab, hop down to the style settings section, and for the buttons are going to be under the color section. So I scroll down to my button section, which is right here, and we have some settings set up here already. I'm just going to adjust some of the issues here. I'm going to leave the color the same, text color the same. Background hover color means when I hover over this, what's the color? Right now, it's set to this checkered box here. If I click on that, I can see that this is set all the way down to basically nothing. So it's kind of clear, which is why when I hover over this, you can see the background color there for the section. I don't like that. I actually want to change that to a different color. So I'm gonna pop open my color palette that I'm using for my site. And we talked about this in part one. I'm just using a color palette from this Cooler's website. They have a wide range of color schemes that you can use. I picked this one that I'm going to use, that I've been using. So I actually want to change my background for my button to this lovely little dark blue or light blue color, actually. So I'm going to just copy this color number here. And in my hover color section here, I'm just going to highlight this section and paste it in. And it's going to automatically put in my color number like that. And I can click select. And I can see what it looks like as I test it. I don't mind that. It's not too bad. Let me just check something here. Yeah, I don't mind that. One of the things that I don't particularly like, when I hover over this, it's hard to read the text. So that's the next section here, is the text hover color. Right now it's set to the same green as the background color for the button. So I'm gonna change that. I want that to be my darker color here. So I'm gonna copy this color number here. And also, because I've used these colors previously, when I click on my color setting here, I will see some of my more recent colors over in this little section in the lower left here. And this dark blue actually is right there. So I could just select that if I wanted to. Or if I want to make sure that I'm using the correct color, I can just go ahead and paste in the color number like I've done. And I can test it out. So now when I hover over it, the font changes to that dark blue. Helps stand out a little bit so I can read it, so users of my site can read it. So I'm gonna stick with that. And what now? I wanna make that text a little bit bigger. So I'm just gonna increase the font size to 19. It'll match my text a little bit more. Border color. I don't have a border set up. Actually, I do. So I'm gonna change that to 0. So now I don't have a border. And I'm all good. I'm all set with that. So I'm gonna go ahead and save my changes. You're gonna get your message confirming that you've saved your changes. And you hear me say this a lot. Whenever I make a change like that, I like to just give the page a quick refresh just to make sure that it's saved my changes. And then I can test them out. Now remember, when you do any of the changes within your style settings, that will appear throughout the website. So those settings that I've changed for my button will take effect for every button that I have on my website, except buttons that we have for forms, like with the lead generation form or any other forms that you have on your site. That's a different section. It's actually right below your buttons. There's a section called form buttons. And all you can do with form buttons is adjust the color. But form buttons and buttons are two different things, so just remember that. All right, so what else do I want to change with page one, home page? I'm going to change this bottom section here. The more I look at this bottom section with this orange, the less I like it. It's just too much for me. So I'm going to go ahead and change that. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my section 3 here. Click on my little blue notepad, and I just want to change my background color. I would like to actually change it to the same light blue color we just used for our button. Just like that. Go ahead and save my changes. And again, after I make a change like that, I like to just give the page a refresh just to make sure everything is working the way it's supposed to. now I'm going to make some changes to my little three sections that we have here. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to give it a nice little border. I have one here, but it's a little thin. I actually want to increase that border width to 5, so it's just a little bit sharper. And I'm actually going to do a what's called a border radius. And we talked about this a little bit before. We covered this a little bit last week. Border radius kind of gives you rounded corners on your border. So I'm actually going to set this to 35. And it gives me this nice rounded look like that. Okay. I'll go ahead and save that. So that's what it's going to look like. And I'm going to do that same thing for all three areas. Do that same one for section 4 here. Give it a nice little refresh. And that just helps those sections just stand out just a little bit more. So I like that. Now the last thing that I'm going to change is down here on the bottom. I'm going to change out this one. The settings for this little piece here. So, Laurel asked a great question. Is there an undo option? There isn't necessarily. Once you've saved your changes, there isn't a way to just undo them. You can make some of these changes and see what they look like and not save them, but there isn't a way to necessarily save their changes. But what you can do, especially when you're dealing with the blue notebook areas, which is called the CSS editor, for whatever section you're using, you can always go and you can click on your little blue notepad icon, and you can go to the settings button, and you can click remove, and that will clear all the settings that you have for it. So for example, I have all my settings here for area 2. If I click remove, it's going to ask me if I want to do this, and I say yes. And then I have to save my changes. So you can see that it's gone back to nothing. I don't have a border, I don't have a background color or anything. So it's gone back to nothing, and I can go ahead and save that, or I can close it. And if I give the page a quick refresh, then it will go back to the way it was. That's about the extent of what you can do for undoing things. Does that make sense for you? Perfect. It is nice. It's a little bit easier to adjust and kind of restart some of the settings for our content areas and containers. It's a little bit easier to do than, you know, if you're changing text and you want to undo something. And it gets a little bit trickier. So, all right, for this section, what I want to do is right now I have a transparent background color. It's basically, I set it to white, and I just adjusted the intensity here, and you can see this in the background. So it's really white, but I just made it a little bit more transparent. What I want to do is I actually want to set it to this crazy orange. But because we talked about this a little bit last week, this orange is really, really, really bright, and I'll show you what I mean. That's really bright orange, right? So what I want to do is I want to just tone that down just a tad by adjusting this little slider. See, that makes it a little bit easier. Now what I want to do here is I want to adjust my text a little bit. And I just want to adjust this text on this spot right here. So I'm going to do it within my text window. First thing I want to adjust the size for my heading here. So I'm just going to highlight this text, go under formats, and go down to font size. And I want it to be pretty big, so I'm going to go with 36. And I can see that in the background. If I can put my cursor up here in the blue area and click, I can move this window. So I can see what's going on in the background there, okay? So then my default text down here looks okay. what I want to do here is I want to adjust this one more time. I want to actually make this white. And an easy way to do that is just to highlight this text, go under text color, change it to white. Now keep in mind when you do that, it's white here, so you can't see it because it's a white background. But it's there, so it's just something that I have to keep in mind if I ever want to change this going forward. My paragraph text here, I want to change the color for that too. It doesn't really matter, but I want it to match the rest of my site, so I actually wanted to change it to this dark blue. So I'm going to copy that. And I highlighted this again, and then I'm going to go up to text color and go to custom. And then I can just paste in my color there. And there it is. Click OK. Save my changes. Now I can see that it's a little bit blue and so on. Last thing that I want to do is adjust some of the settings for this section. I'm going to go into my notepad here. I actually want to get rid of my border radius. I don't like that. I'm going to add some spacing too. I have a little bit on the top and the bottom. I'm going to add a little bit more to the side. Oh, side, not bottom. And that kind of centers it a little bit, gives me some spacing on the sides there. Go ahead and save my changes. And as always, I want to give the page a quick refresh. And I scroll down, take a peek. And that's just kind of how I want it to be. One little adjustment that I think I'm going to make is for section 7 here that we just did. Right now I have a border set to be white. I think I'm just going to change it to this dark blue, but keep it really thin to match the other sections there. So that's what we're going to finish up on the home page. Give the page a quick refresh, and that's what it looks like there. Comment, where are you refreshing your page? This comes up a lot. Refreshing your page is something you can do with any web browser that you do. It has nothing to do with your website. It's all about whatever web browser you're using, whether it's Google Chrome or Safari or Internet Explorer. Every web browser has a refresh button. It's located at the top of the page, generally next to the bar where you enter in your web address. It's always going to look like this little circle with the arrow. If you hover over it, it'll say something like refresh or reload. So it's always going to be there. So that's what you use. Dina mentioned something. My contact form boxes did not show what info to enter in the box for name or email, just the box for message. I'm assuming that she's talking about on here. Deanna, do me a favor, submit that as a question via the Q&A button, and we'll address it later on when we get to the Q&A feature. I'm not going to cover it right now because we're not doing anything with forms right now, but I want to help with that question, okay? All right, so when we finish with the homepage, we're going to pop over to the My Training page. Again, we're not going to be doing anything different. We're going to leave all this content here. We're just going to rearrange it, and we're going to do it, and it's going to look cool, and it's going to be super easy. So that's what we're going to go ahead and do. One second here. Barbara had a question. I noticed that you have an American Spirit add-on front page. Does my home page have to have the ad as well? What American spirit are you talking about? Oh, this is my social media Facebook feed. It's not an ad, it's a Facebook feed. I work for American Spirit, which is also Live Edit, so I just put that there. So that's all. It's not an advertisement for anything. Yep, it's just social media, it's a Facebook feed. If you have a Facebook page, you can do it. So that's all. It's just a piece of content, you know. Just like we talked about before, all this stuff, these are examples. If you don't have any videos, don't post them. If you don't want to have a feed to your Facebook or your social media page, don't put it on there. You don't have to. They're just examples to show you what's possible with your site. That's all. You are welcome. All right, so let's go get started on our My Training page. All right, so first thing I'm going to do on this page, because I have the option with every page, is I can customize it a little bit differently for each page if I want to. Diana has a question. I haven't opened up my website yet. The About Me page has all the information there already that we're seeing. Yeah, all the information here, all this text and everything, this is the stuff that comes supplied with your template. So all of even on the homepage, this paragraph here, these get the conversation started, those are all things that come with the template. So for example, this is the template we're using. This is what it looks like right out of the box. So here's all the text that we're using, content. We changed out some of the pictures, but otherwise I'm leaving everything the same. So on the My Training page, this is how it comes. And we're just going to change that. So this is the supplied content. You have the ability and the option to use the supplied content if you want to. Otherwise, you literally could erase all of it and come up with your own stuff. So you have plenty of opportunity to do that. If you want to use the supplied content, we do recommend that you go through and kind of personalize it a little bit. I'm not going to be doing that here. I'm just going to kind of take with what we have and just kind of show you how you can easily change the way things look. But we do generally recommend to go through and kind of customize it a little bit. So you are welcome. All right. So on our About our My Training page, we are going to first adjust the color scheme for our heading area. Now up here in this, we have our header region. This region isn't on all of the templates. So some of you might have some of the older templates, Foodie Bonanza, Forks and Spoons, etc. You don't have a header region like this where you can adjust it on every page. The newer templates, some of them do. This one does, so I have that opportunity to do that. Otherwise, changing things like your header section, those are things that you can do in the color section. If you scroll down, there is a header section where you can adjust colors and so on. But just like with our fonts and everything, if you do make those changes in the style settings, they will apply throughout the entire site. Okay? So just keep that in mind. We have I've run into some issues during this where people will say, well, I don't have that section on my website. It's going to be a little bit different from template to template, but the same process and the same procedure is going to be the same. So just something to keep in mind. All right, so what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to quickly click on my setting here, and I just want to add a background color. I like this nice little blue, so I'm just going to do that. Save my change. Next up, I'm going to go into my section one here. I just want to make a little adjustment and increase some of the spacing. Nothing big deal, just a little bit on the top. little bit on the bottom. What that does is it spaces out everything on the top and the bottom. You'll see how that applies a little bit later on. Next up with my training text here, it's already in the heading one format, so that's perfect. The only thing that I want to change is I want to make it capitalized and I want to center it. Just like that. Diana has a question. Do you have on the live edit web page opportunities for us to practice customizing the templates without us activating the website? No. The point is you order your website and then you go through and customize it. That's the point. That's how it works. So there isn't a way to practice doing that. Practicing is having your website. You go through and ideally you order up your website. You go through and you customize it, make it look the way you want it to look, say what you want it to say. And then when you're ready for the world to see it, then you make it available for everybody to see. That's the process. Sometimes it takes a little while before you have your website up and ready to go. It's something that you have to consider. Yes, they're templates to help you get started, but it's not a business in a box. It's a website to help you get started. It's your business. It's your health coaching practice. You know, you need to make your website reflect that. But no, there isn't a practice. When you get your website, it's not live. People can't go to your website unless you give them the address to go there. So you can go through and you can make changes. You can have it looking like a big mess. That's totally fine. And then when you're completely done and ready for it to go, then you go through the process of making it live and available for the world to see. So. All right. So now that we have that set up, I also want to move some of this content around. This could one conversation change your life piece. I'm going to use down towards the bottom of the page. So I'm just going to move it out of the way for now and we'll get to it. Same thing with this recipe section. I'm going to use that a little bit later. So I'm going to move that out of the way. Next up, I want to take this text here and I want to move it into this area 5. Actually, no, I want to move it to area 7 because I want these two areas here that are the same, that are side by side. I want to use those because I'm going to make 2 columns of text. So I'm going to put this text here and then I'm going to take my list of who I studied with and I'm going to put it over there. Now you see that they look distinctly different. I'm going to balance them out a little bit. Michelle asks, do our free websites give us the option to drag and drop? Every website works with drag and drop. That's how you edit your website. Everything. If you want to add in new text, you go into edit mode, take your text box, drag it and place it where you want it to go, and then enter in your text. If you want to add an image, you take the image tool and you drag it and place it wherever you want to place it. And then you pick your image. So the entire website works drag and drop. That's the premise of the platform. So it's nice. It makes it really easy to kind of move things around if you want to. Like I said, like I've shown you, you can drag and move stuff around very, very easily. And if you don't like it, you can always drag and move it back. All right. So since this is a little bit off balance, I'm going to go down to the bottom part of my page. And then I'm going to take this text right here. And I'm going to move it up to this section here. Now, sometimes you run into this issue where you hover over a section and it's not being highlighted like this. That's okay. All you got to do is just put it someplace. So this one's being highlighted. I can pop it in there and then I can just try to move it again. So sometimes it gets a little wonky. But you'll eventually be able to get it there. You just kind of play it around. You'll get there. So we have our text here. This section on the left talks about, you know, my education and so on, and the stuff on the right is a little bit more of a list. Now, one of the other things that I want to do, and I'm going to open up a new tab here, and I'm going to go to the About Me page. For those of you that have your websites already and you've gone through it, you know that your About Me page kind of has a lot of the same information as your My Training page. Specifically this paragraph here where it talks about your training. In my opinion, this should be on the My Training page and go with this stuff. So I'm going to move it there. We talked about this last week, I think, but I'll cover it again. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to copy this text from this page, and I'm going to put it on the My Training page. Okay? And you can do this on any page that you want. It's the same process. It generally helps to have two tabs open from one page to the other. Makes it a little bit easier. So on my Training page, what I want to do is I want to go into edit mode, and I'm going to add a new text box. And I actually want to put this text box between these two pieces of text here. So I'm going to take my text box and I'm going to place it there. And you can see it's going to go there because it's been highlighted in that section there. So when I do this, here's my new text box. There's nothing in it. Now I'm going to pop over to my About Me page. I'm going to go into edit mode. And I'm going to click on this text. Now, the easiest way for me to copy this and make sure it looks exactly the way it's supposed to is to go over to the right-hand side and click on this source code button. This is the source code for that content. It makes sure it looks the way that it looks, the font size, everything is all set up that way already, so I don't have to change anything. I click on the source code, there's this window, I highlight everything in it, and I copy it. Now I can go ahead and cancel, close that window. I'm done with this page. So I can close that tab if I want to. On my Training page, in my new text box, I'm going to go to that same spot, the source code button here. There's nothing in there, so I'm going to go ahead and paste in what I copied. Click OK. You can see your text here. I can see it in the background as well. And for right now, I'm just going to click Save. Give my page a quick refresh. So now I have this. I've essentially moved that content from my About Me page to the My Training page. So now we have our two paragraphs here. They're kind of the same thing. You can see the first sentence says, I graduated from Institute of Integrative Nutrition, and so forth. The second paragraph says, I received my training from the Institute of Integrative Nutrition. It's the same thing. So I actually want to just edit this a little bit. So all I'm going to do actually is just highlight this part of the text that I don't think I need and delete it. And I want to actually add some space there too. So I'm just going to actually hit return and just make a little bit of space between my paragraphs and then save my changes. So now I give my page a quick refresh. And now I essentially have four different paragraphs of text along with my list. So it's very balanced, it looks nice. I'm very pleased with that. Another thing that I'm gonna do here is I'm just gonna make them stand out just a tad. And to do that, I'm going to go into the settings for the different sections that they're in. So section 7 and 8. Click on my notepad for section 7. What I want to do is I want to add a background color for this. So I'm going to click on my color, and I want to use this little light gray type of tan color. I'm not going to have a border. Actually, I'm going to have a border. I'm going to have a solid border, and I'm going to use that same color and just make it very thin. Having a border that same color kind of just helps it stand out just a tad. So I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to also adjust some of the spacing just so my text has a nice even kind of border around it. And I'm just going to do an even border all the way around, and you can see that there's nice spacing on the sides there. Go ahead and click save. I think I'm also going to do a little bit of that border radius. I like that rounded corner look. So I'm gonna do that as well. And just like that. I like that. So now I'm gonna do that same thing for section 8. So I can go to my background color. And this is the color that I used. And my border, I'm gonna make a solid border with that same color with a border width of 1. And then I did my rounded corners. And then I'm gonna do just some basic spacing all the way around to be nice and even. Give my page a quick refresh. And now we have this nice little my training session section that is very nice and organized. It stands out, but not too much. So it looks nice, I think. So I've tackled that section. Next, I'm going to go down. If I go into edit mode, I'm going to scroll down. We have section 2 here. Section 2, I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to add a background image. And I'm going to add a background image to the entire section. So for section 2, I'm going to select my blue notepad. And when I get to the background image port, I've already added my pictures myself to save time. So I'm just going to go ahead and select the image that I want. Now when it comes to sizing of my picture, this original picture is very, very large. When it comes to background images, sizing is important, but only in the sense that if you use a small picture, it's going to be very, very pixelated because it's the background for your website. So it's a background for your website no matter who's looking at it on whatever type of screen. If somebody's looking at it on a big 60-inch screen and you're using a very small picture, it's going to be very pixelated and not look very good. So to get the look that you want and the picture that you want, there is some trial and error involved. It's something that you're going to have to spend some time in and just kind of experiment with it to figure out what you want. Again, to save time, I've already gone through and done all that stuff, so I can actually just apply my picture. So once I've selected my picture, for the background color, this clear checkered box, you'll see this little bit of an X there. That means that stands for default. So default is whatever the default background is for the section or the page or anything like that. Just to be on the safe side, I usually like to select this one here, which doesn't have the X, and we talked about this a little bit before. This is basically clear. When I click on it, I can see my color number is 0, so it's transparent, it's clear. I like to do that just for my own personal peace of mind. So it's up to you if you want to do it or not. I like to. Image repeat, I don't want it to repeat. Image size, I'm going to select cover. Cover ensures that the image covers up the entire space. There's more information about these settings in the support portal. There's actually a guide in the support portal. If you do a search for CSS, the first thing that pops up is the CSS Editor guide. It's a walkthrough of how to use these blue sections. So you can learn more about that there. We also did a webinar not that long ago where that's what we covered. So there's a video that goes over the entire thing as well. So if you want to learn more specifics about some of those settings, that's where you're going to find that information. For image scroll, I like fixed. We talked about that a little bit before. I think it's a nice effect, so I like to use it. And position, I like to select center. That just means the focus of the picture is in the center. I don't need a border because I have a background picture. Now spacing, because this is a container, if I move this out of the way, this is actually this section, so it's everything in section 2. So all of those content areas are inside of that section. But I want to make sure that you can see the background picture. So I'm going to add in some space. And because it's a bigger picture, I'm adding in a lot of space. So I'm adding in 700 on the top. I don't need to do anything on the top, on the right and left. And I'm going to do 600 on the bottom. And then I'm going to go ahead and save my change. And I'm going to refresh my page. So how that works is now when I'm at the top of the page, when I scroll down, you see the background image for that section. Okay. Now when we scroll down, you don't see anything else because I don't have any content in the content areas, but we're going to put content areas in there. So right now it just looks like a big old empty space, but we're going to fill that up. So, but that's just kind of a, in a nutshell, how it works. Laurel asks, what's the difference between margin and padding? Padding refers to inside the container or content area. Margin refers to the outside. So if I increase the padding for section 8 here, for example, I'll just do the top. If I do it pretty drastically, you see the padding increases up on the top like that. Okay? Change this back to 15. Now if I were to increase the margin on the top to 75, it essentially moves that section down, creating space. And you can see it's outside of the blue dotted area, so it's outside of that content area. That's the main difference. You are welcome. Both can come in handy sometimes. I mean, it's a good thing to experiment with to see what you like, but both can come in very handy. They're very nice tools. All right, so now what I'm going to do is go back into edit mode, and in this section one here, I'm actually going to take this "Could One Conversation Change Your Life" text and put it there. So I'm going to move it up here. And I need to have my button go along with it. Now you can't see the text there because I don't have anything set up for that container. There's nothing there. There's no background color or anything like that. So what I want to do is I want to add one. Sharon comments 76 equals 1 inch. When you're doing the adjustments, these are pixels. That's what PX stands for. So it's 1 pixel, 2 pixels, 3 pixels, whatever. Like I said, a lot of it is experimentation, trial and error. You're going to find what works for you. So there's no, I don't know how many pixels are in an inch. No idea. It's not something I've ever honestly ever thought about. I just experiment with it, and that's what I like, so that's what I use. So, but that's a good question. So what I'm doing for this section now, so I want to be able to see my text, I'm just going to add a background color. And I just want it to be white. Plain and simple, just like that. But I want it to stand out a little bit, so I'm actually going to put a border on it. And I want my border to be blue. And I'll do 2. So 2 pixel width, that's what I'm using there. Michelle asks, would the pixel be different for viewing on a computer versus a mobile device? No. Not at all. If it, whatever you set for your pixel width, that's what it's going to be, regardless if you're looking at it on a mobile device or a tablet or a desktop computer. Doesn't matter. I don't want a border radius, so I think we're good there. I do want to increase my spacing just a tad. I like to do a little bit on the top and a little bit on the bottom, just to kind of center that stuff a little bit so it's not so pressed up against the edges there. So give that a quick refresh. So we have that. Now what I want to do is I just want to adjust the text a little bit. And because I just want to adjust the text right here on this page, that's all I'm going to worry about. So I'm going to highlight my text that I want. I want the top line to be a little bit more prominent. So I'm going to go down to make it 36. And my next one here, I don't want that to be as prominent, so I'm just going to go with 24. Save my change. There we go. So now when someone scrolls down through the page, they see my background image with the nice little motivational quote. And then there's the little conversation that can change your life, and they can keep going, and it'll take them to the bottom part of the page. And that's the next part we're going to tackle. We are going to tackle this, and this is going to be section 3. So everything inside this area is in section 3. I don't want to do a background color for section 3, but I want to do a border again. So, but I want my border to be a little bit different. So this time I'm going to select my crazy orange. Do my border radiant, border width of 2. And spacing I like to do some on the top. And because this is the bottom of the page, I want to do a little bit of extra spacing on the bottom just to separate it from the footer section, which is this blue section that we have down here. So I've done that. A couple questions. Dinah says, how many pages tabs do we have on the template? Can we add another page? You should have 15 pages available. You can certainly add pages if you need to, or add tabs. I can cover that in the Q&A portion if you want. But for right now, I'm not gonna deal with that. We're not gonna be adding any pages right now. So I'm not gonna worry about that right now, but you should have 15 pages. So. Glazer asks, I have white copy for being healthy doesn't have to be hard. It reverses out of a background of blueberries and is not legible as I'd like it to be. Using Foodie Bonanza, I don't have the drop shadow option for the text. Can I create a solid cutter block within the background for the call to action section? Okay. That's a good question. I'm going to tackle that in the Q&A portion too, because I don't want to sidetrack. I'm almost done covering what we want to cover today. So then we can tackle those questions. So Tammy commented, can you show again where you added the background picture? You add the background picture for whatever section you want by clicking on the blue notepad for that section, then background, and clicking background image, and then selecting your picture. So that's how you do that. All right, so now in section 3, we have our little looking for healthy recipes section here. For those of you that have the Foodie Bonanza template, you know that on your Foodie Bonanza template, you have some sample recipes that, not that one. You have some sample recipes that come with your website. So you have these little sample recipes here. We're gonna create the same kind of thing. So this is looking for some healthy recipes. Check out my favorite recipes. And we're going to list 3 different recipes. So one of the things that I want to do, one of the things that I want to do is make sure that I have recipes added to my recipe application. I already do, but I will give you a quick rundown of how that is done. Go to my dashboard, click on my recipe section here. I've added in three recipes that are coming from the recipe library. The recipe library is a list of provided recipes from IIN. There's a list of them here. You can simply click on them, and if it's something that you want to add, you can click to add recipe library. Then you go to your recipe section, and you have the ability to edit that recipe if you want to, add in a photo, and so on. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. There's a whole section in the support portal about how to use the recipe app. So all I did is I added three recipes to my application, so I have three that I can link to. So I just wanted to show you that that's where I did it. All right, so first thing I want to do is I want to set up my looking for the recipe ideas text here. And what I'm going to do here is this check out my favorite recipe link, which is my button. I'm actually going to delete that, and we're going to make a new button a little bit later. So there's that. Now I just want this text to just stand out a little bit more. So just like we've done before, I'm highlighting it and I'm just changing that size. And then saving my changes. So there's my text. Next up, we're going to add in our three recipes. Because we're going to be dealing with images, I'm going to tackle this question here. Laura says, with regard to the pixel size for photos, is there a general rule of thumb of how large we need images to be in order to not look pixelated? There isn't a general rule of thumb. It all depends on where you're going to use the image. If you're going to use the image for a section like this, then it doesn't need to be very big. If you're going to do a large background image like I did, then your image is going to have to be a little bit larger. So it really depends on what you plan on doing with your images. For me, when I'm uploading pictures that I want to use on my site and adding them to my file manager, because we have the option within the website to select different sizes for different things, and you'll see that in a moment here, I generally like to kind of have a basic outline for image size. If you upload an image that's very, very big, for example, this image that I used for this background, when I placed it, you saw that it was 4,000 pixels wide. That's a very big picture, and it takes up space on your website, and it also affects how fast your website is going to load when people are accessing it. A larger picture takes a little bit more time to load, and so on. For this example site, I don't need to worry about that, so I didn't. But for the most part, in my general recommendation, and I'll put this in the chat window, I would not have images that are any larger than I'd say 1500 pixels wide is the max width. Height is really going to depend on what size that you're using. Sometimes you're going to have pictures that are going to be taller than wider. But generally, I wouldn't go any more than 1,700 pixels tall. So, Valeria asked why. Again, because with your website, when you go into your dashboard and you look at your account info, and you look at your current package, there's a thing called disk space. That's your storage limit. For me, because I have a trial, or I have a demo website and everything, I don't have to worry about this stuff. Those of you with trial packages and basic packages and so on, you only have so much disk space. larger images take up space. There's also another section called bandwidth. Bandwidth is how much traffic can be directed to your website without there being any issues. In 99.9% of all cases, it's nothing you ever have to worry about. But if you have your website chock full of pictures that are huge, it's going to take a lot for people to load those images and watch them. So that's kind of why you don't necessarily want really, really large pictures. As far as the dimensions, 1500 pixels is roughly, I'm on a Macintosh iMac computer. 1500 pixels is going to be pretty much the width of the screen. Right now, the screen that you're looking at is probably about 1200 pixels wide. So it's pretty big. So 1500 is a little bit wider. I like to have that kind of set just in case, you know, you have people that happen to view images and so on larger screens. But if you have an image that's 4,000 pixels wide, think about that. That's four times what you're looking at right now. So it's very, very big. And like I said, it takes a long lot to load. So that's generally why. So good question, though. So now that we talked about pictures, we're going to add in a couple. Take my image tool here. And again, I've already added these pictures to my file manager to make it a little bit easier. So I'm going to take my first image and I'm going to place it into section 2 and select my recipe image. Now this picture that I'm selecting, because I'm using the image tool, when you select your image, you'll see it'll say a suggested size. This kind of makes the pixel question kind of irrelevant in a way, in the sense that the image tool is always going to give you a recommended size based on where you're putting the picture and the original size of the picture. So for example, I'm putting it in this very small box. So it says these are the dimensions that we're going to use for your picture. And they're doing that based on that size of that box, but they're also basing it on the fact this is how big the original picture is. So if I had a much larger picture, it would still condense it down to this same 360 by 205, probably. But that's where that stuff comes into play. So the image tool will always give you the best possible sizing to make sure your image is clear and sized properly. So that's a nice little feature. So once I have my image selected, I click place my image. There it is. Now for each one of these sections, I want to make sure that they look the same. So in order to do that, I have to make sure the images that I'm placing are the exact same size. You can see that right now this image and this image are not. If I click on this image, I can see that this is 360 by 235. And the reason for that is because the original dimensions are different. This question comes up a lot, especially for those of you with the Foodie Bonanza templates. When you place images in sections like this and you want them to be uniform and look the same, you have to make sure they are the same size, okay? So now in section 3, I'm gonna place a new image. And I'm gonna select my folder. This one is also 360 by 205. And the reason for that is the original picture is the exact same size. I did that by editing the size of the picture. You can do that within your file manager. We did a webinar a while back covering everything you need to know about photos. So that is an excellent resource. We actually walk through editing some pictures in the file manager to help you get that specific size. Now, as far as figuring out what that size is, just like everything else, it's trial and error. You find the size that you like to get the image sizing that you want and get it the way that you want it to look. Go ahead and place my image. There we go. Now, for this one in area 4, I don't want to use that picture, so I can click on it. And I can actually click on Browse Images, and go back to my selections here and just replace it with a different picture. Again, same picture, same size. So it works out very nicely there. So there's my three images for my three recipes. All right. Now what I'm going to do is I need to add in some text so you know what those recipes are. So I'm gonna bring my text area here. And this is actually the sweet and sour glazed salmon. For right now, I'm just gonna leave it like that. Do the same for here. And do the same for the third one. Now, I want to be able to link to those three recipes. So I want to be able to have a user be able to click either on the picture or the title of the recipe to get it to be a link. So to do that, I actually need to open up my recipe section. So I'm gonna go here and I'm actually gonna right click on this and click open in new tab. Opens up a new tab. These are my recipes. Haven't done anything with this yet. We will get to that in one of our other parts. We'll go through and we'll add in categories and make it look all pretty. But right now, I just have my basic recipes. So I want to link to each one. So the first one is the sweet and sour glazed salmon. So I'm gonna click on that recipe. I want my link to go to here. So because we're linking from one part of the site to the other, the only information that I need is this right here, or everything to the right of the .com. So I can highlight that, copy it, and go into edit mode. First, I'll set up the picture. When I click on the picture, if I go to the advanced tab and up here, down at the bottom, we have our link, and that's where I can paste in what I copied. And since I'm not leaving the website, I can leave it to a same window, or I can select it to open in a new window if I want. That would open a new tab just like we just did. But I'm gonna leave it at the same window and just save my changes. Now I'm gonna do the same with the text. Highlight my text. Change it to format. I want my format to be paragraph. That's my main text. So I wanna do that first. Then I wanna insert my link. Just like we did here, paste in that information that I copied. Don't need to set a target for new window, so I'm all good. Click OK. Now I can see that my text is now made a link, so I'm all set there. Save my changes. I'm gonna do that same thing for the peach salsa. So now I'm gonna go back on this, click on the peach salsa, highlight my information for my link, copy it, go back, click on my image, go to my advanced tab, paste in my link there, do the same thing with my text, change it to paragraph, that's my main text, and then add in my link. See that change there? And we'll do it one more time with the Thai quinoa. Highlight that information and copy it. Go to the advanced tab here, pop in that link. Highlight my text, change it to paragraph, insert my link. Save my changes. All right, so now I've done all that stuff. I'm gonna give my page a quick refresh. Now I can check my links to make sure that they work the way that I want them to. And they do, so I'm all good to go with that. Now I'm just gonna style them and make them look a little bit prettier. Laurel has a question. I want my image to show on my website and then the text show up over that image only when someone hovers over that photo. How do I do that? That involves some special coding, some special CSS work. It's not something that you and I can just easily do. You'd have to have someone who is skilled in creating web code to be able to do that for you. If that's something that you wanted to have done, you can check out the different paid services that we have. That's something that we could do for you. But it's not something that's easily done. So. Glazer says, I'm interested in putting three testimonials on my homepage instead of the recipes because I put quotes in place of the photos and link to a case study instead of the recipes. Absolutely. Absolutely. You can put whatever you want in those spots. You can delete what's already there. Yep, you can literally do whatever you want with those. So if you wanted to put those there, three testimonials instead of recipes and link to that, you certainly could. It's no different than what we have on our homepage, where we have, instead of three recipes, we have a blog section and a video section and a social media section. You know, you can put whatever you want in those content areas. Diana asks, once you activate the site, even without making it public, do you only have a year? Is that through IIN or Live Edit? You get your website for a year. That's how long your trial period starts. It's or less. It starts from when you order your website. After your one-year trial expires, you are asked to choose a monthly subscription package to continue with your website. It's through Live Edit. We partner with IIN in the sense that IIN graduates get a website for a year. So, but it is a Live Edit website. All right, so I just want to quick, we're almost done, and then we can do our general Q&A questions, and I'll get to the questions that have been thrown in there. But I just want to finish this up, and then we will be done for today. So the last thing that I want to do for these sections is I want to style it a little bit, kind of make them look a little prettier. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into the settings for each of those sections here. And I want to add a background color, and I want to use this dark blue that I've been using before. And again, this is your recently used colors, so I've already used that, so that's what I want. I want to have a border. I'm going to do a solid border, and I'm going to use that crazy orange, because the crazy orange goes really well with the dark blue. And I'm going to do a 1 pixel border width. And I want to do a 30 pixel border radius. So it's going to give me a little bit of a rounded corner. Now, it looks kind of funky here in the background. And the reason for that is my image is taking up most of my container, most of my content area. So now we're going to pop over to the spacing. And we're going to adjust the spacing a little bit. Do some on the top. And do some on the right. Bottom, I don't need to do a ton. So I'm not going to worry about doing a lot. And then we're going to do the same on the left. So we can see this is what we're getting. Now you notice when I did that, it spaced out it made the image smaller. And the reason for that is because I essentially made that content area smaller with my padding. Again, that affects everything inside your dotted lines. So it makes that image smaller, kind of reduces the amount of space that we have there. I'll go ahead and save that. And we'll do that same thing for section 3. And my border color. And my width. And my spacing. And we'll do that same thing for section 4. It's really nice once you do it a couple times. It makes it pretty easy to remember how to do that. And we have our spacing. Go ahead and save that. Give the page a quick refresh. And there we have our settings there. Another thing that I want to do is I want to make this look just a tad better with the text. Because this is a longer name and this is a longer name and that's a shorter name, if someone were to look at it on a smaller screen, you'll see that it looks different like this. So I want to be able to kind of accommodate for that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on my text and I'm actually going to change the font size. Highlight my text and I'm going to go to size 20. But because I want it to be a little bit bigger than 20, if I go to size 24, I think that's a little too big. So what I want to do is actually after I've applied a size, if I go to my source code again, I can see my font size right here. I can actually change this to whatever I want. I don't want it to be 20 and I don't want it to be 24 and I want it to be 22. So I can just change the number there and click OK and save my changes. One last thing, I want to center my text. I'm going to do that same thing here. So I don't forget, I'm going to center it first. Now I'm going to go to font size 20 or 24, 36 or any of those is fine. And then go into my source code, find my font size and just change it to 22. Save my changes. Now with this one, because it's a smaller name, put it centered. Make my size, change it to 22. Now because it's just two words, I'm just gonna go to the end and hit return. And just give it that little bit of space. So now they all have the same spacing there. So when I save my changes, it doesn't matter if I look at it in a different screen size, they still say the same. Okay? Now finally, what I'm going to do is I want to add a little bit of space between the image and the text. Easy way for me to do that is I'm just going to take a blank text area and create what we call a spacer. And a spacer is literally just a blank text area. So in my text window here, all I have to do is hit spacebar a few times and click save. And there's my blank text area. It spaces it out very nicely. So I'm going to do that here, click save, and do that one more time, click save. So there we have that. Now finally, that button that we deleted before, the check out my favorite recipes, I'm actually going to add in a new one. I'm going to put that here in section 7, take my new text area, pop it in section 7, and all this is going to say is check out more of my favorite recipes. And I'm going to make this a link. I'll save this right now. I want this to link to my recipe main section here. Excuse me. So I'm just going to click on this in another tab. And again, this doesn't look pretty, but we'll fix that later on. I want it to link to this section here. So just like we did with the individual recipes, I'm just going to highlight the portion of the URL that I need. So everything to the right. Excuse me. Go ahead and copy that. now down here where I'm making my button. Set my text as paragraph font. Insert my link. Now what I want to do here in the class section, this is where I can add it as a button. I can actually select one of the different button formats that we have. I'm just going to go with button one. Click OK. And you see your button created there in the background. Last but not least, I want to make it centered. Save my changes. You can see that I need to space this out just a tad. So I'm going to go into edit mode, and for section 7 there, I'm just going to add a little bit of spacing on the top. And there we go. Give my page a quick refresh. And there we have it. So this is our new My Training page. This is what we start. This is what the it comes with the template. This is how it looks when you first start. And in the course of our session today, we changed it to this without really changing a whole lot of anything. Added some pictures, moved some stuff around. Otherwise, it's the same content, but it looks completely different. So there we are. Next week, we will continue on and we will do our About Me page. We'll change this page up a little bit, and that'll be that. So that is it. That's my topic for today. So I don't have anything else to cover in addition to that. Like I said, we'll pick up on the About Me page next week. We are going to be working through the About Me page next week. Then we will hit up the Work With Me sections and get the health coaching page and the My Approach page. Take care of the forms pages. I got something cool to do with the forms pages. Those will be easy. And that'll pretty much take care of it. So we're going to go through the different pages that are associated with the template that you get and just kind of show you how easy it is to go through and customize all that stuff. So pretty simple. Nothing is going to be anything different than what we've already done, what we did today. We'll just be able to do it for the different pages. So that is that. Michelle asks, is that considered one page? Yes. This is a page. The My Training page it's a page. So an easy way to find out how many pages you have and you're using, go into the Pages section. In your Pages section, you see all these different tabs. Every tab that has an icon that looks like this counts as a page. That's why the icon is supposed to look like a page. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These ones don't count. This one does. That's 6. This one does. That's 7. There's 8. There's 9. There's 10. There's 11. There's 12, there's 13. So with my site right now, I have 13 pages. So, all right. Okay, like I said, that's the topic for this week. I don't have anything else to cover. The rest of the time we're gonna designate for our Q&A session. So, we have one question that came into the chat. Were the recipes that you used come from a specific website? No, they came from the recipe application. That's what I showed earlier. Go to your dashboard in your recipe application. Recipe library. These are all the provided recipes from IIN. Every one of them here. I picked 4. I have 4 that are added to my section. I used 3 of them. We covered that a little bit earlier. You just simply click on a recipe. If you like that recipe, add it to your library. And you'll show it added to your library. So we're not adding anything new. We just use the stuff that's provided. You can certainly create your own, add in your own recipes, but for this example, I didn't. I just used the provided ones. So Not a problem. Like I said, there is an entire section in the support portal on the recipe application. If I can get to the support portal properly. Seriously? All right. Yeah, in the support portal, if you scroll down, there is a section on the recipe application. It actually, the how to set up links talks about exactly what we did at the end of our session when we set up links to those three different recipes. This video covers that same process very easily. And then the other videos and guides talk about how to add in your own recipes and create categories and so on. So you can learn more about that there. But like I said, the rest of the time we're going to devote to our Q&A session. So our video is actually going to stop here. So if you have things to do, you don't have time to sit around and go with the Q&A section, you are by all means free to hop off. The video for today's session will be posted later on this afternoon. So if you don't care to stay for the Q&A, I want to thank you for your time and your patience, and hopefully you found it helpful, and hopefully we will see you again next week.